our series, Neighbor. So over the next 4 weeks, we're going to examine what loving our neighbor actually looks like on a daily basis. This series will dovetail into our Christmas series, which will be called Mass, right? We're going to put Christ back in Mass, right?
Amen.
We're not going Catholic. We're going to celebrate Mass for all of December, right? So, and this series will dovetail into our Christmas series, where we're going to encourage everyone by the end of this, when we learn how to love our neighbors and what it means to love and how do I love and when do I love and what is love, when we start covering each one of these points each week, that will all lead to the end where you invite your neighbors to church, amen? So that it all come together. And so to start us off, so week number two, we're going to talk about how do I love. Week number three is going to be who do I love. Week number four is going to be when do I love. And this week, so if you're taking notes, you want to write down the title. So the title of today's message would be what is love? Because you have to have understanding of what is love before you can do anything about it. You have to know what it is. And in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, it says, the most important of all, continuing to show deep love for each other. For love covers a multitude of sins, right? So we have to know, and it says, what's most important of all? To continue to show what? Deep love. To continue to show deep, this is for all you people that like to say, we need to go deeper into God's Word, right? Continue to show deep love, right? For each other, because it covers a multitude of sins. And I'm not, if you were one of those persons that say, we have to go deeper into God's Word, we gotta go deeper. Until you can handle the shallowness of God's Word, you better take care of that wading into the water before you start going deeper. If you can't do that, no matter how deep the water goes, you ain't going to make it. Amen? So just throwing that out there. So we're going to define love. So what is love? And as I was preparing for this month, looking up all the scriptures for love and going through all this stuff. So if I was to take one verse a week, and just cover one verse that has the word love in it. Like it specifically says, you have to continue to show deep love for one another because love covers a multitude of sins. So I was to take one verse like that a week and preach on just that one verse, it would take over 16 years to cover all the verses in the Bible. That just mention the word of love. Not counting all the scripture that has to deal with the concept or the idea of love. Because ultimately, this whole book, the Bible, is the love of God written down for us. And we could study it for lifetimes and never reach the bottom of the depths of how much God truly loves us.
That's right.
So that being said, I'm really going to try to keep the sermon under 35 minutes. But know this, that we are not getting anywhere near what God has for love, right? Because it just goes beyond any, we could spend our entire lives studying this idea of love. So, but the Greek word of love that we're going to cover today is agape. And there are variations of this this word love, this agape love, throughout the New Testament. Agape perfectly describes the kind of love Jesus Christ has for his Father and his followers and his disciples. Agape love is the term that defines God's immeasurable, incomprehensible love for mankind. Agape love is his ongoing, outgoing, self-sacrificing concern for the lost and fallen people. Like, this is the definition of agape love, if you're not tracking it. Agape love, or God gives this love without condition, completely to those who are undeserving and inferior to him. Which is good news for us, because that is us, right? We are all undeserving of God's love. Because we have a sin nature. We have something that's inside of us that turns our back away from God because sin has entered into the world. And our natural instinct, our natural inclination is to not do what God wants us to do. Because that's the part of the fall of man. That's part of sin, is saying, I can do it myself. I don't need God to help me do it. We're all undeserving of His love. And we're all inferior to Him. How many of you have ever created anything? Right?
Children.
You created children, right? But even with the children that you've created, God formed them before you were even born. He knew who they were long before the foundations of the earth. So ultimately, you didn't create them anyway. God did. I know I just made your theology all messed up, right? But God has created everything. And until we can create heaven and earth, we are inferior to God. Right? Because can anybody create life?
No.
Again, we're going back to the children. Well, we created them. We didn't. I created them. Right? We cannot take dust, form it into a person with mud and clay and all that, and breathe life into it and become a living person. Right? Only God can do that. Because ultimately, God's the one who created the dust, the water, and all that stuff that you put together anyway, so you didn't even create that, right? So, anyway, so the... That's good. Before, I've only got so much time. I really am going to try. So the passage that we're going to cover today is found in the chapter of Scripture that almost anybody that's been in church for any amount of time will know. It is the chapter of love. It's kind of like the whole chapter, or all the chapters in the Bible, all the verses. This is the one that's specifically dedicated to love, and everybody says it at weddings. And so we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, right? The chapter of love. But this passage is always read at weddings. But the problem with this passage always being read at weddings, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. We should read it at weddings. We should understand what love is. But it has led many people to view this description of love as a unique and set apart only for those who are to be husband and wife. But that's not what it's... God didn't write this chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, to say, this is what you're going to read at weddings. Okay? It's not what it's designed... So it's good for weddings, right? But I'm not saying it's not... We should read it at weddings, right? But it's led to this idea that it's only for husband and wife on a special occasion during their weddings. And this is about... This is about love. Isn't just for... these special occasions. This is supposed to be how we love everybody. It's not conditional to husband and wife. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting with verse number 1, it says, if I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, right? If I could speak every language on earth and speak the language of all the angels. If you've ever read this version, this section of scripture in the Message Bible, it's awesome. We're not going to go through the whole thing. I'm just going to start it off here. In the Message Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 says, if I speak with human eloquence and angelic ecstasy, but do not love, I am nothing but the creaking of a rusty gate. Right? Mm-hmm. There's even who sings a song?
Right.
All they do is quote the scripture out of the Message Bible, and they put music to it. Right? So, it's like Chris Tomlin or something. You guys can look it up.
Yeah.
But if I could speak all the language of the earth and of the angels, but don't love others. Right? This section of scripture is specific for believers. If you could speak all the languages of the earth, if you could speak all the languages of the angels, but if you do not love others, you would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. So what does that mean? That means you could go around making all kinds of noise, speaking with eloquence and your words just come out right, and you're well educated, your speech is like you could run for president and all that stuff, and everything you say would just come out perfect. But if you don't love, what good is it? You're just noise. Just the noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. What for who a clanging cymbal?
The clanging cymbal.
That sounds good, right? That's a nice, you know, especially when you just hit it once and it's right. Now do a clanging cymbal. He doesn't know what a clanging cymbal is, right? Even still, speaking with eloquence or a clanging cymbal. That you're not playing music with that, right? That's not doing you any good at all, right? If you don't love, you could have the best speech in the world. You could speak to people, you're done for. You could have the language of all the earth, you could know everything, but if you don't love, it would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Verse number 2 says, if I had the gift of prophecy, right? Now, this is awesome, right? Who wants the gift of prophecy? Right? That's awesome, right? You better be right, but that's awesome. Because if you say you have the gift of prophecy and you start prophesying, and what you say doesn't really come true, we get to stone you out back, right? And I'm not talking like, I'm talking the rocks, right? You're going to be put to death. We're just going to the Old Testament. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans, how many want to know God's secret plans? Not just for everybody, just for your own life. Right? Is there anybody that would like to know the secret plans that God has for you? Right? We all say yes. We all want to know God's secret plans that He has for our life. But do we really? Because if He showed us the secret plans, would we go through with it? Probably not. Right? But if you knew, if you had the gift of prophecy and you knew the secret plans that God had for your life, and you possessed all knowledge, like you could go to Jeopardy and win indefinitely. Right? That's awesome, right? Because I like to learn new things. I like to, see how new things are done. I may not understand everything, but I like to learn new things, right? If I knew God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, right? That's an awesome section of scripture right there. If we could just have the faith to move mountains, and the faith to move mountains is the size of the
mustard seed,
right? Just a little bit of faith to move the mountains. Like, have you guys ever been to the cowboy dinner tree?
Yeah.
You know when you're coming up Highway 31?
Fort Rock.
And you're heading back towards 97, and there's like that straightaway, like you can see 97 up the road a little bit. When you look right in front of you, I don't know if you've ever noticed this, when you look directly in front of you, you see Mount Bachelor. Mm-hmm. As soon as you turn onto 97, Mount Bachelor is way over here. Right? I don't understand how that happens. But if we had the faith to move, I'm going to do that as an illustration. I'm going to videotape it one day, and we're going to play it. Because I don't think some of you realize that's what happens when you drive up 31 and get on 97, is Mount Bachelor literally moves like miles. Like it's there, and then it's way over there. All you do is turn on the 97, right? If you just had the faith to move mountains in your life, with all knowledge and understanding everything that God has planned for you, and had the gift of prophecy, if you had such faith, you could move mountains. But don't love each other, I would be nothing. God, look at all this stuff you could do. If you could do all this stuff, but if you don't love, what good is it? You would be nothing. Verse number 3, if I gave everything I had to the poor, right? That's pretty noble. That's, where you take everything that you have and give it to the poor. Like, some people are like, we need to be a New Testament church. Okay. Give everything that you have, sell it, and give it to the poor. That's what they did, right? You want to be a New Testament church? Do that. We need to go deeper, Pastor. It's okay. Time to downsize, right? So, if I gave everything I had to the poor and even sacrificed my body, some versions say to be burned at the stake as a martyr. If I sacrifice my body, I could boast about it, right? Because you could get to God and say, look what I did. I sold everything I had. I gave it to the poor. I defended the faith to the point of death. I was sacrificed as a martyr. But if I don't love others, I would have gained nothing. And I know that when we look at all this stuff. So this is, God is showing us in these first three verses here, you could do all the stuff. You could go to church, you could sit in the pews, you can sing the song, you can say hallelujah, amen, lift your hands, shake hands, do all that stuff. You could fellowship, you could show up continually. But if you do not love each other, it's worthless. If you do not love, you have gained nothing. Because we can all play the game. We can all show up to church and have prophecy spoken over us. We can even start to see God's plans for our lives. We can start to possess knowledge. When we start to possess knowledge, I don't know everything in the Bible. Right? Just so we can be clear with that. If you have a question I don't know, I'm going to tell you. I don't know what that scripture means, right? I don't have all knowledge, but I know one who does. The one who wrote the book, the one who gives knowledge, and I just preach what God has shown me, and He's revealed to me and things that I've learned. And if there's one thing that I've learned inside the since becoming a Christian, is what love is.
Amen.
And what love isn't. And how the churches pretend to love one another, but there's no love found in the church.
Mm-hmm.
I know. I've only been saved for a few years. We've been married for 17 years today. As we continue to grow in our relationship, our love is not the same as when we first got together. It's just not. Our love has evolved into something else. And when I listen to people talk about their wives and stuff like that, and like, you know, this all this nonsense, I'm like, I don't understand. The love that we have continues to grow. It continues to manifest itself. It continues to get stronger. And I can't imagine not being without kids again.
Yeah.
Right? Those brownie points, yeah. But I can't because, it's like, boy, you've been married for 17 years. And it hasn't felt like 17 years at all. But it just flies by because our love is continuing to grow. But when I became saved and started to understand what it is love, what is the love of God, what is this love of Christ, and the church is supposed to reflect the love of God. That's what a Christian is all about, is to be Christ-like. And you can see it in some churches, and you don't see it in others. And I've been to both, all right? Because we had a friend who, when we got saved, they went to the church in Germany, and they just out of the blue, him and his wife moved to Seattle, and he was coming through, and he just stopped by the house the other day. Haven't seen him for, what, 16 years? So, just swung by the house. He's got more hair now because he's not in the army. But he's growing a beard because he's not in the army, right? But to show up and for us to just reminisce and like, you know, back, do you remember the what we used to do in church in Germany? I'm like, yeah. And because the church we got saved in and we got started in and became believers in, we have not found in America yet. It's not bad or indifferent. It's just we haven't found anything like that. Because when we would go to church in Germany, it was every day. Every day the doors were open, we were at the church, and we did not leave the church almost till it's time to go to PT the next morning. Like, all night, fellowshipping with each other, showing love for one another, being connected, enjoying, and being a family.
Right. Amen. Amen.
And all the people that have left that environment have come back to the States, and as soon as church is over, everything's gone.
Mm-hmm.
And we struggle with that. Because that's how we started, right? And it's almost went backwards a little bit. But to have that connection where there's so much fellowship and you just want to be around each other so much that you just don't want to leave. Or you're like, I gotta go to work in the morning. Oh yeah, me too. Let's play some more games. Right? To love one another. And I know that this section of scripture, some of you are like, I don't understand God's word. I'm gonna take those first three verses, I'm gonna make it as simple as possible for everyone to understand. Let's pretend that you show up to a job interview. And you are impressive. Like, your resume is on point and everything is laid out nice, it's clean, there's not too much information, it's just all the points are there, everything is just impressive. You get all the questions right when they start asking you them, and you can articulate everything that you want to say when they ask you certain questions, and you have this professional reliability about you, and you're organized, and you have this great attitude, and you did all this stuff to prepare for this interview, but if you forgot to put your clothes on for the interview, all that means nothing. Because you're not getting hired. Right? Depending on the interview you're going to. But if you did all that stuff and was impressive with your presentation, but you were naked, what good is it? It's worth nothing. If you have all the actions and the deeds of a Christian, but do not do them with love, it doesn't matter. Because love is the foundation of who we are. Love is the foundation of what we're supposed to be. Love is the foundation of our faith. It should be the foundation of our lives. It should be the foundation of this church. Because the mission statement of this church is to live like Jesus and share His love as fully devoted followers of Christ. Right? There's a second part to that. We're still working on the first part. To live like Jesus and to share His love. Because that's what Christ did on earth. He came and shared the love of His Father with us. He showed who His God was through Him by His actions. If Jesus did all that stuff but didn't love people, it wouldn't be worth anything. Mm-hmm. Right? He could walk on water, but if He didn't love people, what good is it? Mm-hmm. He could raise people from the dead, but if He doesn't love them, then why do it? As a church, our actions and our deeds should reflect the love of Christ. Because if you don't reflect the love of Christ, it's going to show. Because if we know we're supposed to love, as believers, we all kind of understand that, hey, we're supposed to love other people. And we kind of get that. But what is love? How do we love? When do we love? Who do we love? How am I supposed to do all this stuff, right? And remember, it's not about what you do because Christ's already done the work. But because of what Christ has done for you, it should be a natural response to love other people. And if you don't love people, the Bible says, if you're not loving people, I doubt that you're a Christian. That you've been bought and saved by the blood of Christ. Because if you've been bought and saved through the blood of Christ, your natural response is to love people.
That's right.
Amen.
That's the way it works. And I'm still soft up, don't worry. I think we're gonna make it through this week. But what is love? If God says you can do all this stuff, but you don't love, it's worth nothing. If you put on the show and put on the facade, but you don't love, then there's nothing to gain. So what is love? So the next four verses tell us what love is. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting with verse 4, it says, love is patient. Right, it should be up on the screen. Love is patient, as we patiently wait. It's there. Love is, I'm not turning around. Love is
patient.
Love is
patient.
Love is
patient,
right? Love is patient. How many of you need patience in your life? Right? If you pray for patience, you better be ready. Right? Because God's going to put you through that test. But it says love is patient. This is like with our kids, when they do stuff moronic and they start acting fools, we have to be patient with them because we love them.
Amen.
Right? Now there is a point where patience ends and discipline begins, but you still love them out of patience, right? You say, well, I told you not to do that. You're going to do it anyway. I'm going to watch you get hurt. Right? Because I love you. Maybe it's just me. Love is patient. Love is kind. If we can only have kind, patient Christians in the church. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous. Love is not boastful. Love is not proud.
Amen.
Right? So God's telling us this is what love is. It's patient. It's kind. Love is not proud. It is not boastful. It is not jealous. If we know what love is, we can define what love is. Does that reflect your life? Does it reflect the church? Is a church a place of patience and kindness towards people? Or is a church a place of jealousy, boastfulness, and proud people? We're going deep. Right? Verse number 5. Love is not rude. We could stop right there. Right? I've seen the way people drive down 97. Right? I apologize. Right? Especially during construction. Don't try and get in front of me because you're not going to get there. Right? But love is not rude, right? It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. And it keeps no record of being wronged. This is some hard stuff to cover right here, right? Love is not rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of being wrong. If we love people, we should show that love towards people. We should reflect the love of Christ, because there were a lot of people that demanded and were rude to Christ. Okay? But he loved them anyway. He died for their sins just as much as he died for our sins. As the soldiers were nailing him to the cross, he loved them. And he prayed for them. Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Right? And it keeps no record of being wronged. Because if anybody has a record of being wronged, it's Christ. Because look what they did to him on the cross. And he could keep that, just that record right there. But he has no record. Verse number 6. It does not rejoice about injustice. Instead, it rejoices whenever the truth wins out. That's what love does. Verse number 7, love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Love is always hopeful. Love encourages through every circumstance. That's what love does. And if you were to take all these places in these four verses, and you were to remove the word love, and you were to replace them with the word God, in all these passages, this is the most perfect illustration of how God treats us. Because you would say, verse number 4, God is patient and kind. God is not jealous. God is not boastful. God is not proud. God is not rude. God does not demand his own way. He is not irritable. He keeps no records of being wrong. God does not rejoice about injustice, but God rejoices when the truth wins out. God never gives up. God never loses faith. God is always hopeful. God encourages us through every circumstance.
Amen.
That's what God does.
Amen.
Love is not what God does. Love is who God is.
Amen.
And that's the point we're trying to make today, is love is not just some action. It should be who we are, because we are God's children. We are part of his kingdom, are we not? Because God is love. It's not something that he does. It's who he is. We
Amen.
Should be love to other people.
Amen.
Because I wonder, if you were to take out the word love and the word God, and you were to place your own name in that same section of scripture, how would it read? Jeremy is patient and kind. Jeremy is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. He does not demand his own way. He is not irritable. He keeps no record of being wrong. He does not rejoice about injustice. Jeremy rejoices whenever truth wins out. Jeremy never gives up. He never loses faith. Jeremy is always hopeful, and he encourages through every circumstance. Is that what your life is like? Because if you can insert your name in there and make those qualifications, or would it be a little rough to read that with your name in there? We're going to close. I told you I'm going to try to keep it short. I don't know how long we can go on, but just give it in. But that's what love is. Love is not something that God does. It's who God is. And having an authentic love for people has to be the foundation of all the works in our Christian life. Everything we do has to be upon the foundation of love. When the same authentic love is shown in every area of your life, people will notice. When it's not consistent, and you're not reflecting the love of God consistently, people will notice that too. And they will spot it real quick. Because you can do it just the same with other people. When they're not loving, you know right away. When they come to church and they put on the Christian facade and they say, oh, we love you, brother and sister. But then when you see them out in the community and that love is not there, you notice. Right? And we're not talking this agape love that's in this section of Scripture. It's not like this sexual attraction between people. It's a deep love that's unconditional. The same love that Christ showed us throughout His Father. This unconditional love, this undeserving love. Is there a group of people you encounter in your life who don't model this love? Is there a group of people that you've encountered that don't model this? Is there a church that you've encountered that does not model the love of Christ? Are there people in your family that do not model this love to you? Does your spouse model the love of Christ? Do you show the love of Christ to your coworkers? Do you show the love of Christ to strangers? Can they see that there's something different about you by the way that you interact with them when you walk around day to day that says, I don't, your past is your past, I love you. I don't love your sin, right? But I love you. Can your life be summed up in those four verses? Because if you're not sharing His love, which is part of the mission of this church, and if you don't believe in the mission of this church, then you got to find somewhere else that lines up with you. But to live like Jesus and to share His love. If you're not sharing His love, why not? And you can't share His love living as hermits, stuck in your house all day. Right? Why not? Why are you not sharing His love? What steps do you need to take to start sharing the love of Christ? Whatever your next step is. I don't know, maybe you say, I've been hurt and I gotta get over that. That's, welcome to life. We've all been hurt by someone or something. But we've all gotta find a way through Christ to make that next step to say, this person hurt me, they betrayed me, they stabbed me in the back after I shared something with them, but I love them anyway. And I'm not going to let that incident hinder me from moving forward in Christ. If you're not sharing His love, why not? What steps do you need to start taking to start? What steps do you need to take to start sharing the love of God? Because what is love? Love is who we are. Love is who God is. That's the simplest definition you're going to get from me today. I mean, we can go through the dictionary and all that stuff. But love is who God is, and it's who we are, and we should be as believers in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Does everyone stand here?